diversity, equity, and inclusion for the Culture Club.
KUAM News headlines are presented by Calvo's Insurance, protecting Micronesia for 85 years. Matson, celebrating 25 years of commitment to Guam, Micronesia, and the CNMI. Cars Plus Finish Line Express is now open at Cars Plus in Mitee. The state-of-the-art car wash is now open 7 days a week from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. McDonald's of Guam, I'm loving it. And King's Restaurant, serving your local breakfast, lunch, and dinner favorites for over 45 years.
Ahead on KUAM News Primetime, outdated procedures for foster care placement and a staffing shortage. The local health department questioned by senators during a second oversight hearing.
Recent threats to the island and the region. Now UOG students want answers by hosting a forum with military and GovGuam leaders under one roof. I'm Julian Hernandez with the story coming up.
Multiple instances of dead and dying animals cruelly being abandoned here at Guam Animals in Need. It's why the Jigo shelter is speaking out, saying enough is enough. I'm Mitsuki Hirayama with the story.
Half a day and good evening. Welcome to KUAM News Primetime. I'm Nick Delgado.
And I'm Destiny Cruz. Thanks so much for making this a part of your day. Well, protection for the island's foster children, social worker pay, recruitment and retention, and staffing, all part of why the Department of Public Health and Social Services took the hot seat before senators overnight.
It was round two of local health officials going before their oversight committee, an important discussion after two foster children were recently abused.
Public Health Director Art St. Augustine defending his social workers.
They are committed to being an advocate for victims of child abuse and neglect.
A commitment to safeguard children in the foster care system. Senators holding a second oversight hearing Tuesday night after another alarming arrest is reported in recent weeks. The defendant, Ike Elikios, stands accused of sexually abusing a little girl for years. He was in a relationship with the victim's foster mother. And weeks prior, police arrested Ryan Cruz for allegedly molesting a foster child placed in his care.
We are all taking all necessary steps to address the situation and ensure the safety and well-being of all involved.
Senators cracking down on the process.
These things are slipping through the cracks because these inspections are not happening.
You need to fix what you did wrong yesterday and move forward. I mean, I'm trying to be very positive, put a little humor in your in this thing. Because you know what? We're not here to beat you up. We're not here to insult you. We just want you to correct what the issue is. Get it fixed.
St. Augustine and his staff laying out these new background check procedures, showing that multiple law enforcement agencies and the courts are now more involved.
Does anyone else here have any other idea of how to better monitor the homes besides what we're doing now, the foster placements?
We're looking to a round table where you could help us also develop policy, and we can put to you before for a conversation what other states are doing with regards to background checks.
Speaker Therese Cherlahi, Health Oversight Chair, reemphasizing the health director has the discretion to deny applicants based off any public arrests or suspicious activity found out about them online.
So you can use your criteria as you determine, I mean, your agency, correct? You don't need a new law.
No, what we wanted to do was expand to be very to list the different types of offenses so that also the applicants are very clear.
St. Augustine admits part of the problem is the delay in bringing on new hires plus the high stresses of the job. Meantime, senators pointed out the department is in crisis mode and should now focus on stabilizing the system that already failed two foster kids this year.
A man accused of soliciting a 17-year-old girl to exchange explicit photos with him denied the charges handed down against him in a new indictment. 19-year-old Joshua Kumbao pleaded not guilty to a superseding indictment before Judge Vernon Perez in Superior Court today. He is charged with electronic enticement of a child, attempted possession of child pornography, and indecent electronic display to a child. As we reported, the girl allegedly told police she had sent Kumbao photos of her genitals because he wouldn't stop asking. His trial set for June 21st.
A man accused of kidnapping a woman, holding her hostage, and assaulting her in Tumon last June had the criminal charges against him tossed. Jacob Solomon faced charges of strangulation, family violence, kidnapping, and felonious restraint after his accuser alleged he took her to his condo and took her phone before brutally beating and threatening to kill her. Superior Court Judge Maria Senzon granted the dismissal. The case now dismissed without prejudice at the prosecutor's request, noting the case would likely be transferred to the military's jurisdiction.
The public will have a chance to voice any concerns it may have on the environmental impact of a massive new missile defense system for Guam.
Acting Governor Josh Tenorio was notified that the Missile Defense Agency will file a notice of intent, which initiates the public comment period. Nestor Lakanto has more.
It says it right there in the Biden administration's fiscal year 2024 Department of Defense budget, a key line item. Defense of Guam against the missile threat from China, $1.5 billion. Even as far back as 2 years ago, military officials were talking about the urgent need. Former Indo-PACOM Commander Admiral Philip Davidson put it bluntly during a 2021 Senate Armed Services Committee hearing.
Guam is a target today. It needs to be defended, and it needs to be prepared for the threats that will come in the future.
Davidson, now retired, then laid out all the reasons why Guam must be protected.
Most importantly, we all have to understand, Guam is U.S. territory. We have 170,000 U.S. citizens living on Guam. Their defense is homeland defense. We have 21,000 U.S. Servicemen and women and DOD employees as well, plus their families. It's a deep water strategic port. Major fuel stores, munition stores, command and control. It is a major power projection airfield for us in the region.
Now, 2 years later, one of the first big steps is to seek the affected public's input on the environmental impact of such a missile defense system. The public comment period begins May 5th through June 27th. The notice of intent also starts the scoping process, which is meant to identify what the key environmental issues are. Scoping meetings are scheduled for June 14, 15, and 16 at the UOG Fieldhouse, Okudu High School, and Southern High School. Congressman Jim Moylan welcomed the start of the public input process, also saying in a news release that he's urging Congress to pass an additional $147 million that Indo-PACOM says it needs. And Acting Governor Josh Tenorio said in another statement that during these times of increased tension in the Asia-Pacific region, the Defense Department has assured him it will do everything it can to protect Guam. Even 2 years ago, former Indo-PACOM Commander Davidson said, "Time is of the essence."
The structure that's out there right now, the THAAD radar, is not capable of meeting the current trajectory of threats from China.
Nestor Lakanto, KUAM News.
And a Navy spokesperson says the details of the project will be posted by the Missile Defense Agency on a website by May 5th, Eastern Time.
Defending Guam is important, but how do the rest of us prepare in the event of a threat? That's what students at the University of Guam hope to bring to light during a forum set for this weekend.
The discussion centered on the crisis in Taiwan and the impacts to our region. Julian Hernandez reports.
The threats in our region have gained the interest of many who call the island home, like Tisha Sanchez.
There were reports of a suspected Chinese spy balloon that passed over Guam, and as we know, that kind of sparked some concerns with the island.
Sanchez is an MPA student at the University of Guam. She, along with her peer Tony Negros, and the rest of the administrative law class at UOG have closely watched as Guam has once again made national headlines.
And more recently, we learned that there were Chinese warships outside of Guam waters. So our class thought that it was important to have a discussion with the key leaders to inform the residents of Guam regarding what is happening with Taiwan and the increased tensions with China and the U.S.
And that's why this class is hosting the forum called Understanding the Taiwan Crisis, Its Impact on Guam and the Region.
There's a lot of issues going around inside the island. And we kind of forget that, you know, outside the water, there's like a major crisis that is going on. And it could definitely impact our island as far as security, political influence, or even economical turmoil.
The group calling on a panelist of military and local leaders they can engage, like the Joint Region Marianas Chief of Staff, Captain Michael Smith, Acting Governor Josh Tenorio, and others.
We need at least a minimum awareness of what we can do to be prepared in case something happens. Things can happen, and there could be war. And so we at least like to the public to be informed and be prepared, well prepared.
The forum is set for May 6th this Saturday at the UOG School of Business and Public Administration building, room 131, from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. You can also watch virtually by using this QR code. Julian Hernandez, KUAM News.
Dead and injured kittens were abandoned at Guam Animals in Need 2 days in a row. We caution our viewers, the images in this next story you may find rather gruesome.
It's a cruel crime leaving the Jigo Animal Shelter frustrated, as it's happened multiple times before, and also why they are speaking out in hopes to spread awareness. Mitsuki Hirayama has the story.
Security footage showing the moment a box of dying kittens were abandoned at Guam Animals in Need Monday morning. A man in a white truck is seen leaving the baby felines at the Jigo shelter's back gate, leaving the scene straight after and never calling it in.
Unfortunately, these kittens were already in what looked to be pretty bad shape, and they were just brought here in an effort, you know, to do the right thing, of course, but unfortunately we were not open, and so they were left at our back gate.
Kane Executive Director Allison Hadley sharing it's not the first time people have dumped animals at Gain.
Unfortunately, this is not the first time people have even tossed adult dogs into the play park just to get them inside the fence, and we show up and there's a new dog all of a sudden.
31 animals, most of them puppies and kittens, were dumped at Gain during closed hours just last year. Just this past Tuesday, another box of kittens abandoned in the front gate even during open hours, and too gruesome to show, a dead feline even left in a plastic bag.
It's here in front of the Jigo Animal Shelter where those kittens were cruelly abandoned here, right in front of a sign that says don't drop off animals, with a number here to call, also saying that you're on camera.
Abandoning animals is a crime, Hadley reminds the community as she cradles Tuta, the only surviving feline.
Even though this is the shelter, to leave them here, it's still abandonment. You know, you can't leave donated items in front of Salvation Army either. It's considered dumping. So, you know, same situation. We're just trying to do right by the animals, trying to do our job.
She adds there's an emergency number on their front sign you can call for help when the shelter is closed. That's 671-988-1615. There's also no longer a wait list, so you can easily schedule a drop-off by calling 671-653-4246.
Even though it's uncomfortable, not everybody has all the time, you know, just try and communicate with us so we can try and work it out with your schedule and do what's right for the animal.
And to prevent any more needless suffering. Mitsuki Hirayama, KUAM News.
Thanks, Mitsuki. We've got more news coming up.
Keep it here to KUAM, your leader in local news.
KUAM TV 8, live on Peacock. Check out our live channel, NBC shows, live sports original programming, movies, plus so much more. Visit peacocktv.com/local or download the app and subscribe today.
I'm checking my vital signs, got my battle lines going to war again. Feeling the rhythm inside of my chest, all I need is just a pen. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. I believe we can write a story. I believe we can be an army. We are the warriors who learn to love the pain. We come from different places, but have the same name. As a fire rages, our hearts are never tame. Cause we were born for this. We were born for this.
Stop!
Welcome back to Primetime. Federal education officials on Guam touring some of the island's public schools.
The visiting group is with the U.S. Department of Education. They're seeing for themselves what's been done to improve the violations previously found with the Guam Department of Education's Head Start program.
After handing down citations to the Guam Department of Education for violation in some of its school's Head Start programs, federal officials are back on island to check in on the progress. The U.S. Department of Education noting environmental, health, safety, and child rights violations back in January, with D.L. Perez, C.L. Titano, Chief Brody, and Marshall Sablon among the elementary schools identified in that January report.
Walkway to the playgrounds, restrooms that are broken, toilets, playgrounds that are not fenced, and then just indicating on the staff that is needed to monitor based on the ratio that is required through federal regulations.
The feds requiring an action plan from Guam DOE's Head Start office to correct the issues. Senator Chris Barnett caught up with the visiting group at D.L. Perez today.
Some of the issues that they had cited D.L. Perez for in their January visit was unsafe playgrounds. And so in response to that, D.L. Perez had roped off the playground facility.
Officials remain concerned about the federally mandated amount of supervision for students and the poor condition of the school's facilities.
They did note that there have been improvements since they came to inspect these facilities in January, but that there are other areas of concern that they feel still need to be addressed.
Still, Barnett says the visit was a positive one, a sentiment shared by principal of Weddingale Elementary, Evangeline Iglesias, after the school site visit this morning.
I heard positive things from them today, and I'm saying, gosh, I'm so glad. You know, they're not here to assess us, they're here to support us.
KUAM was not allowed to join USDOE's inspection. Guam DOE officials saying speaking with them during the inspection is against their federal counterparts' guidelines. The Guam Education Board is expected to hear the results tomorrow.
Now to a heartbreaking update up north. After 3 days of searching Saipan waters, authorities suspended the search for a 15-year-old boy who was swept out to sea on Saturday. He was swimming with friends at Marine Beach in Kegman Village.
The search was officially called off on Tuesday at 6 p.m. The CNMI Department of Public Safety says despite having resources from multiple local, federal, and military agencies available for 72 hours, they could not locate the missing swimmer. Legal authorities urged the public to call 911 to report any sightings related to the search. Packages from decades ago tell us.
That's what a group of maritime archaeologists visiting Saipan are trying to find out. As regional correspondent Tomas Manglotna reports, they're enlisting the help of local veterans.
All we have today is all that we will ever have. And if we lose them through construction, through dredging, through looting, through pillaging, then they're gone. They're gone forever.
That's the motivation behind Chips of Exploration and Discovery's visit to Saipan, the nonprofit recruiting local veterans to dive into their research on a vessel in Saipan's lagoon to investigate shipwrecks and sunken aircraft from World War II.
We're out here collecting data on the sites, and so training the local veterans and also a veteran group that we brought with us is going to help us sort of increase capacity.
The data they gather will contribute to their long-term preservation and educational lessons for NMI schools.
We're also collecting eDNA, which is environmental DNA from the sites, to understand more about their preservation, but also their health and how they act as artificial reefs out here and support the blue economy of heritage tourism and fisheries.
We want to promote careers like these and like efforts like these to build awareness of our cultural resources, our historic resources.
Dozens of veterans filled the room at the American Memorial Park to learn about the opportunity. U.S. Army veteran and public school teacher Paul Murphy signed up.
Something I really would like to do is to like turn the ocean green, you know, like do the 3D fish farming here, be able to get more opportunities on the water.
Tomas Manglonia, KUAM News, Saipan.
NMI Governor Arnold Palacios withdrew the appointment of Jose Joseph Rios for Commerce Secretary. He informed the legislature of his withdrawal without giving any reason. though he says he would resubmit Rios' appointment at a later date as of Monday. Frank Cabrera is now the acting commerce chief. He worked in the Workers' Compensation Commission as its director for over two decades after working at the Department of Public Safety and private sector.
Pretty much I'm just getting my feet wet on what is the role and direction, what we'll be doing. But definitely, you know, we want to continue on with our goals and mission, you know, to proceed on with the fundamental development.
Cabrera says the work ahead is tough and that it is up to the administration to appoint him for Senate confirmation. While the drone industry could take to the skies in the Northern Marianas soon. Representatives from Bellwings Aviation and Valacor met with CNMI lawmakers this week to share plans for drone delivery manufacturing and workforce development in the region. They hope to service the Marianas, including Tinian and Rota, by setting up delivery systems in the island.
They're also working with the Northern Marianas Technical Institute to develop local labor for the industry. In a statement, Acting CNMI Governor David Apatang saying, "We want to see our residents grab these advantages to improve their livelihoods." Apatang wishing the businesses luck amid the island's fiscal crisis.
More relief now available for households struggling to meet rental and utility dues. The new application period for Cycle 6 of the Guam Emergency Rental Assistance Program kicking off this week. Applicants who have not exhausted their 18 months of assistance for combined rent, rent arrears, utility and utility arrears from March 13, 2020 to today may be eligible for a continuance of assistance.
For more information, you can call the Government of Guam Relief Center at 671-475-2060 or the ERA office at 638-4518 or 19 or email era@doa.guam.gov. The ERA office is also on the second floor, suite 219 of the ITC building in Tumuni, and the GovGuam Relief Center on the third floor of the Bank of Hawaii building in Hagatnya.
All right, and now for a look at your world at home.
Here's a bird's eye view of the mountains in northern Saipan.
This view plus more Chamorro music streaming on Isla Digital Radio. We've got that QR code on your screen as well.
Do you ever wonder how your favorite products make their way into your local stores? Most arrive on state-of-the-art mats and vessels that transport containers of food, household items, equipment, and supplies into the islands every week. Because we know that you depend on us, we work closely with our partners to ensure that our shipments arrive on time, all the time, so you can find your favorite products when you need them. We transport the region's most precious cargo that supports successful businesses and promotes a better quality of life for our families. Matson is proud to have been the hometown shipping carrier for Guam, the CNMI, and Micronesia for the past 25 years. And you can count on us to be here for generations to come.
Our new McDonald's Spicy Chicken McNuggets are just the right amount of spicy. A small to medium Sprite kind of spicy. Let's get a McFlurry after this kind of spicy. But if you get the mighty hot sauce, it's a napkins up for foreheads now kind of spicy. This came from McDonald's kind of spicy? Because our spicy chicken McNuggets, breaded in tempura and made with cayenne, are just the right amount of spicy. Unless you remember what I said about the sauce. Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
KUAM Sports is brought to you by Docomo Pacific. Better together.
Nothing but net. Welcome to KUAM Sports.
Let's check in with our partners at Clutch Guam for the final score. Don't go away. We'll have more news in a moment.
KUAM Sports is brought to you by Docomo Pacific. Better together.
Don't need a work break, keep the smile on your face. The moments you can't replace, and I'll be around.
Wherever life takes you, we're always here for you. Calvo's Insurance. Count on us for life.
Dude, KFC's Double Down is back?
Double down, double, double, double down. Chicken, chicken, bacon, chicken, chicken, cheese. Double down, double, double, double down.
Buy a Double Down on the KFC app until March 18th for early beta access to Diablo 4.
You know what time it is.
What time is it?
Now time for the latest in upcoming events happening on island.
Let's check in with our Jason Salas, who has today's news bites.
Thanks so much, guys, and hot today. I'm Jason Salas from The Hotspot, and here's what's happening all over island with News Bites. All right, you want to join our friends at PBS Guam on May the 12th. They've got an unforgettable night of live entertainment to support Guam's only public broadcast station. Did you guys also know that PBS is located on Sesame Street? On Guam, that is the coolest thing I know. Tune into Channel 12 or the PBS Guam YouTube channel from 7 to 10 p.m. on the 12th for a night of exciting programming, and make sure that you donate to keep quality programming on the air. Elmo says, watch PBS. Our friends over there do very, very good work. A shout out to our friends. All right. Heads up to all coaches at all levels. A spring coaching clinic for the sports enthusiasts will be held and led by men's national team head coach, our buddy E.J. Calvo, assisted by current and former national team coaches. It's a two-day clinic on May 5th and the 6th at the UOG Calvo Fieldhouse and is a great opportunity for coaches, trainers, and parents looking to work with young athletes and help develop players and teams. Email basketballguam@gmail.com for more. And a good friend of ours, Dr. Yit Kalam, and the foundation that bears her late son's namesake, the Ash Lam Foundation and Ipinakgun Campus Suicide Prevention Program, are presenting Reckoning with the Primal Wound. It's a screening of a film that takes place on Thursday, May 11th from 6 to 9 p.m. at the UOG Lecture Hall, of course, in Manila. Good people doing good work on the island. So make sure you check out their events and make sure you check out the Hotspot every weekday, 11 a.m., Peacock, YouTube, Facebook, KUAM TV8. Back to you guys.
Let's check what you all submitted on KUAM.com.
It's time for your Coldstone Creamery Birthday Club shoutouts.
It's the middle of the week, everybody, but you know what? Wednesday is the perfect time to have a party. So get out those cakes, get out those candles, and get some birthday wrapping, because we say happy birthday to Santino Munoz, who is getting love from his family at JRM 911 Dispatch. Santino, thank you for your service, and we wish you a happy birthday. Ray Patamanior, the man up front. Man, I got to tell you, Ray's a member of our family here at KUAM. He's a member of our team. Super, super nice guy. We always go up. He's got really funny stories. And Ray, we wish you a happy birthday, man. We wish you the very best, and we'll see you at Showtime. And belated birthday wishes going out to Iris Cruz. Happiest of birthdays to our favorite sister, Iris. Iris was born on April the 30th. Happy birthday to Santino, Ray, and Iris today.
Happy birthday, Ray, from our Master Control, and happy to everyone birthday else celebrating out there. That's your primetime show. Thanks so much for watching. I'm Nick Delgado.
And I'm Destiny Cruz. Stay safe and have a great night.
KUAM News Hotspot is presented by Calvo Enterprises, Inc. Off today, and happy Wednesday, everybody. We are coming to you live from Harmon. We are on YouTube. We are on Facebook. We are on Peacock. We are on KUAM TV 8, and we are KUAM, and we bring you this show. See, I'm using collective pronouns here because we want to bring you all of the amazing stuff that is happening on the island from north to south, east to west. We're bringing it all to you. And on the show today, we will give you all details to this year's EMS Week, as well as the activities taking place to recognize the tireless work of all of the men and women who work in the emergency medical services industry. Shout out to all of them. Also, HMI Guam aims to help veterans navigate VA Claims and Benefits, and we are going to hear about the very critical work that they do. That is coming right up. Also, we'll give you everything that's happening around the island with News Bites, and we close out with Nihidzan KUAM, and today we are going to tell you about coconut milk. I'm hungry for that. I'm also hungry for information, and May 22nd through the 26th is EMS Week. If you didn't know, it's an EMS Week full of events and activities recognizing emergency medical providers. And joining me now on the KOM couch with details as to what will take place, we recognize these fine folks, just two of the many, many people in our island to do that kind of work, our Lieutenant Angel Lagas from the Guam Fire Department. LT, how are
you doing, sir? How are
you? Very good to see you. As well as Ginny Serrano. She is from American Medical Transport. How are you, Ginny?
Sorry, it's Access.
Oh, Access Medical Transport. There you go. Well, very, very appropriately named, because you're providing access to these very services. And I would dare say that Access is something that is at the heart of EMS.
Correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's talk about EMS Week. What is the theme of this year, LT?
So the theme for this year is going to be your emergency service begins. Mm-hmm. So that's what it is. So uniquely, it's going to be matching what Guam, because America's, that's where America Today begins, mm-hmm. is in Guam. And it's a week-long set of activities that usually will start it when Gerald Ford was president, November 4th, 1974, signed it into proclamation to have declared EMS Week, mm-hmm. to actually recognize EMS responders and stuff like that, mm-hmm. nationwide.
And, yeah, and the men and women that do this kind of work, I mean, it's, you know, private sector, Guam Fire Department, obviously, our friends over in the federal sector. You guys are responding and helping people out when they are at their in most need.
Correct.
Yeah. So what does it mean to you first, LT? Because I know you've been doing this kind of work a very, very long time. It's one of the ways that you serve our island. So what does it mean to you to be, you know, like on the front lines, literally, of, you know, providing help for people when they need it the most?
So what it is to me, what it means to me is that it's gratifying at the same time, because it's a role of a EMS responder to actually go out there and help the public. So not everybody can be emergency medical services responder. It takes a unique breed of individuals to actually do it, because if you're not used to doing certain things like lifting people, stop the bleeding, doing cardiac arrest or CPR and stuff like that, it takes a unique individual to do those kind of things.
There you go. Well, you have to have the heart, obviously, to do correct. That kind of work. You also have to have the brain, because you're thinking and acting very, very quickly.
That is correct.
All right. Okay. So, Ginny, I'd like to talk to you. What events do we have for this week, and how is the community going to be more aware of the very fine work that you guys do?
I think for the main one, we have for Wednesday on the 24th, it's the Parade of Lights. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, you can come join us.
Okay, very cool. What are some of the questions that you get? Because I know if people see you in uniform, or they see you guys, you know, going around helping people, what are some of the questions that, you know, maybe like even kids ask you guys? Did they say like, is your job scary? Or, you know, what do you do? How did you get into this this like line of work? Did they ask that kind of thing?
This will be my first.
Your first EMS week? Okay, cool. So, I mean, is it fair to say like this is still like your rookie year?
Yeah, kind of.
Okay, first EMS week. But what does it mean to you? Like, I'll ask you the same question I asked the LT of, you know, what does it mean to you to be able to do this work and to really be there for people?
Oh, I just want to help the community.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very, very cool. Well, let's, LT, let's walk us through, like, what are some of the daily duties that as emergency medical services professionals, you know, like when you first, you know, come in the morning and everything like that. You got your game face on, you're ready to do the job and everything. Where does your headspace have to be?
So the first thing you have to think about is making sure that your equipment is all properly ready to go and serviceable. So that's the first thing you would do. But prior to that, you're going to get a briefing from the outgoing shift to let you know what's going on and tell you if there's anything, if there are any shortcomings with equipment or whether supplies you might need. Once you do that, get the briefing, then you go inside your apparatus, medic unit or the truck itself, and actually inspect it to make sure what they briefed you is actually correct, and make sure everything's properly stored and stuff like that, and properly, which is have supplies for the rest of the day. And once you do that, make sure the vehicles are running operationally. And once you're done, then it's going to be up to the station OIC to decide what's going to happen for that schedule of events for that day.
Mm. And this is on a best case scenario. If calls aren't immediately coming
correct.
In, or people say like, oh, you know, I need help. I may have fallen down. Yeah. I saw a car accident. Yes. You know, like my mom's having shortness of breath or something.
So funny you should mention that, because sometimes during halfway through the briefing, there's an actual call from 911.
Yep.
And they call the fire station, and then during the briefing, you have to actually cut it short and just leave the station to go out there and respond.
That duty calls, and you guys answer that call, and we appreciate it. Mm-hmm. All right, Ginny, maybe you can shine light on what brought you to this line of work, and what was your your decision to get involved with EMS work?
Oh, I know when I came here, it was like during COVID. Mm-hmm. And I just pretty much needed a job. And then, you know, I started in the office. And then I worked my way up to, you know, drive an ambulance. And
that's really amazing, if I may say so. First of all, thank you for sharing that. Because there's COVID was a time, I know, when a lot of people who were, I know from personal experience, were studying to be nurses or to be doctors. They kind of called it the Great Shakedown, too, because a lot of people were like, you know, that's not what I signed up for. This is way too intense. Mm-hmm. I thought this is what I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. I can't handle it. And that's totally cool, right? It really showed the people that, you know, as the LT said, this isn't a job, it's a calling, right? Mm-hmm. So you came into the kind of work and you wanted to, you know, jump right in. And what does it mean to you? Like, you're driving around, you're seeing the island, but you're also seeing, you know, again, you know, people when they say, can you please help me because I need assistance?
It means a lot to me. We're private ambulance, and we do kind of do things differently from what GFD does. Mm-hmm. So we do non-emergency.
Mm-hmm. And that's a very important point to make, because even though it's EMS week, there are a lot of you who work in that capacity to say, like, if you need patients who are non-ambulatory, right? They can't drive themselves to, like, maybe a dialysis appointment or to another kind of medical appointment. Okay. Mm-hmm. So LT, what is your relationship with people like Ginny's company and everything, that, you know, you have this synergy in making sure that everybody can be taken care of?
So for the Guam Fire Department, we do actually emergency transports. Sometimes we do non-emergency transports. If there's a calling and we're busy and stuff like that, and we can't actually transport patients from the hospital to the residents or residents to the hospital or to their appointments, we call on to Access Medical Transport or any other non-emergency transport units here on Guam to let them know what's going on.
So it is a big network, basically.
Correct.
Yeah, and we try and have as many different outlets to assist people when they need. Okay, Ginny, what else is going on for the week?
For May 22nd is the proclamation signing at the governor's conference room in Attleloop. And then on the 23rd, we're gonna go to the schools and basically something like a career day.
Okay, very nice. So, I was asking earlier, you know, what are some of the questions that the kids ask? They're probably going to have, like, a lot of questions there. And, kids, their attention span can be, you know, really, really short. But when you guys go out there in uniform or you say, I'm the one that you call when you need help and everything like that, you know, their eyes just, like, light up. Because they know, and justifiably so, that everybody in your profession, you guys are rock stars, you guys are heroes, and you guys are inspiring them. So, maybe on that note, LT, if people are watching this right now and they were like, you know, I've always wanted to do that. The people that we had on the hotspot seem really, really cool. How can people get into this, like, line of work? What kind of training do they have to have, and what should they concentrate on in school?
So for becoming in the fire department, because it's fire emergency services and stuff, it's just not medical. There's actually academies that they actually go through to actually learn the trade and everything else, get them up to speed to where the rest of the firefighters are at. At the same time, they're actually going to the school at Guam Community College that actually hosts emergency medical technician training and stuff like that. And that usually takes anywhere between 3 to 4 months. Mm-hmm. So that's what they have to do. Once they successfully pass that, they can take the National Registry tests. And once they get certified, when they finish it and they graduate, they can get their local license at Public Health to actually practice being an EMT.
Okay. And then Ginny, from the private sector and everything, what would you recommend to, like, people who might be watching this and they're like, yeah, that sounds like something that I'd like to do. Like, what's the best way that they can get started, and how can they be an effective staffer?
Okay. So starting off is the same. You have to take the same the classes, and you can also do it online. I've known someone who's done it online, and then the NREMT as well. So the standards are the same. Mm-hmm. And then you just apply to, if you want to be in Fed Fire or GFD or even a private ambulance company.
Okay. So again, physical fitness is, it really, really helps.
Yes,
also, you probably have to be really good in science, right?
Pretty much, at least learn the basic anatomy, and of course, a little bit of what oxygen does and what kind of medications will do for you and stuff like that.
Yeah, okay. And then I know, Ginny, you shared with us that you actually got into this line of work through COVID. LT, you've been here throughout. You've seen a lot of different things. You've been through medical emergencies during typhoons. You've been through the pandemic and everything. Yeah. How has the profession changed, if at all, in all the time that you've been involved?
So on Guam, traditionally, we only had emergency medical technicians. Then we went to the advanced emergency medical technician. Now Guam actually has their first paramedics at the get-go since beginning of this year and stuff like that. So the highest level of care is paramedic, which I am. I'm a paramedic. So prior to that, I was actually an advanced emergency medical technician. So.
All right. Yep. Well, Lieutenant Angel Lagas and Ginny Serrano, two of the many people in our island. Again, it's part of a proper network that is making sure that you and I can be safe. So thank you both and happy EMS week.
You as well.
All right. We congratulate you and we really, really thank you for everything that you guys do. All right. And please stay tuned. We will be right back with more show right here on The Hotspot right after this.
Only Pizza Hut lets you surround your favorite pizza with greatness. The one and only stuffed crust pizza tempts your taste buds with melted cheese stuffed inside that amazing crust. And at just $18.99 with one topping, the stuffed crust pizza is truly irresistible. So grab your slice of pizza perfection with cheesy goodness baked right into the crust. The stuffed crust pizza, just $18.99 with one topping. Only at Pizza Hut, the island's best.
All right, you know how we do things on this show. We always, always, always thank those who serve. We'll never get tired of doing it. Thank you for all of you who are serving right now and for our beloved veterans, those who put on the uniform, those who took up arms in service of our country. We thank you so much. We love you. And if you are a vet right now, this interview is for you, because if you are a veteran overwhelmed when it comes to navigating through the very treacherous waters often of the benefits process, there is a veterans boot camp. It takes place on May the 15th through the 17th at the Chalampago Mayor's Office from 5:30 in the evening. It's a couple hours long, but it's going to give you information that you need to use. I know we need to get these benefits to you if you are a vet of any branch of service, because you certainly deserve it. I have here Vince Borja and Jen Paz. Santa Rita Pete, by the way, is a veteran. Pete, thank you for your service as always, man. We appreciate it. Vince, thank you for your service as well.
Thank you. Thank you for having
us. All right. And Jen, did you serve?
Oh, yes, I did. 20 years active duty. Retired Army.
There,
oh,
three armies.
Yes.
Three soldiers in the house and everything. First of all, thank you all for your service. Even Santa Rita Pete, Air Artillery, too.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. And I think God bless the two of you. And I know you're representing many people that realize that there is a deficiency in our community, sadly, that vets aren't able to get the benefits that they so richly deserve as quickly as they need them and everything. So, Vince, what gave rise to the motivation behind this whole program?
Well, you know, I served and I got out and I have gone through the process. Luckily for me, I was able to do it in the States, or actually as I was leaving the military, where they pretty much kind of held our hands and ensured that I had somebody who kind of supervised the entire process. But coming back to Guam and meeting a lot of other veterans who got out and didn't go through that, had that same luxury of me having somebody help me through that process. A lot of them attempted to try and get their benefits and have gone to like the ASIN office or the TSIN office, who most would give up because it could be confusing. Because one, you have all these different offices that should provide, I mean, the stuff that we provide, which is really just, you just go here or you can go on the website and fill out the information. It requires different things depending on what type of account you have. But yeah, that you know, meeting a lot of people, especially my generation, and then working, meeting this group and now being a part of the group and meeting a lot of our elders, especially the Manumco, the ones who served in the Vietnam War, who probably applied for benefits 20, 30, 40 years ago, probably got denied. But there have been a lot of changes. The process has evolved. A lot of things that you couldn't claim back then, you can claim now. And so it's just, it takes a lot of effort and a lot of education. And so that's where we come in. And that's where I wanted to come in and share my experience. I'm very technologically savvy. And so it helps to have that experience and to help, especially our elders who really struggle with technology.
I gotta say, Vince, if you can bring your Instagram savvy to this group of veterans, and you know, I mean, really communicate with them, and you know, reach out to them, establish that, you know, that direct connection with them, and because you're very, very good on Instagram, this is a way that we can definitely make some progress. And Jen, again, such wonderful work that's being done and sorely needed, because I mean, not to criticize, but this is almost like against the anathemaulic virtues that we as Guamanians like truly believe with every fiber of our being is really helping our neighbors.
Yes, I got motivated to help out. So I came back on island around June 2021. My official retirement date was August 1st of that year. And when I met this group, HMI, I actually attended Boot Camp 12, and I saw the need and the number of people that attended, and I saw the process of the struggle of what they were going through, and I was like, wow, I really need to come and help out.
So essentially, you went to boot camp twice. You did it first when you went through basic training, then you went to this boot camp. So, no, I think that's a wonderful marketing device to tell people. It's like, hey, vets, you got to go through boot camp one more time, but this one is going to connect you with the benefits that you have.
Yeah, well, really the benefits you deserve, because that's the other thing too. And like, that's really our message, because that's the other thing, or those are also the other people that we want to really connect with, are the ones who feel like, you know, they're not worthy enough, or their service was not worthy enough of trying to get the benefits that is available to them, right?
I've heard that from some, and they were like, you know, I only served like 2 or 3 years. I was only like an E2 or an E3 and everything, but not everybody who served
is
worthy.
Definitely, and so, you know, hopefully we can connect with those, and they're listening and they're watching, and we encourage them to come to the boot camp and just listen. And, you know, I think at the end of the day, especially those that have medical conditions that maybe, that's the other thing too, is that you didn't necessarily have to get injured during their time in service. It helps to support the case, but there are things that maybe you may have twisted your ankle and it wasn't a big deal then, and then maybe it got worse over time and you did something when you got out that probably irritated it, and now it's a big issue. And so,
or PTSD, it may not be a physical injury, right?
That's the other thing, right? And that's you're right, like the non-physical, you know, what am I trying to say?
The lingering trauma, and your mental health is such a wide spectrum right now.
Yeah, and so like,
and many of our vets have this.
So like for me with PTSD, right, it's like, of course, when you're in the military, you feel like the way your emotions are and the way your mental health is, that's the way it's supposed to be, right? Especially when you move up in the ranks, you become a leader. You have to be stronger than those that, you know, that report to you. And so you think that that's supposed to be the way. Then you get out of the military and you come home and you transition into a civilian life where those feelings are not the mental state that you needed to be, the fight or flight, right? Mm-hmm. Mentality in the military is not something that you need to have in the civilian world. And so that transition, like, that's where you need to get connected, because there are going to be a lot of issues that are tied to that, that you don't know exist until something bad happens. And then you go off on your mom, or you go off on your friend, or you're driving on the road and you want to avoid like a bag. I mean, I still do it, right? And you don't realize how much that affects you, because you think that that's just the way you're supposed to be, but that's not.
Well, let me pose this question to Jen, because, you know, I've done several interviews, like especially in the last year, about reaching out to vets, and a lot of vets, for whatever reason, are a little bit bashful. You know, they can say like, again, you know, they may think like, you know, I'm not worthy, I don't qualify for this, but for the ones who aren't able to, like, you know, make that first step and say like, yes, I need help, or I would like to know what resources are available to me. Jen, make that case to them about why they should come forward and just say, yes, I need to be part of this community.
So when you come to our boot camp, we say you serve, you deserved, right? Injuries come in many forms, and especially sometimes, you know, physical, mental, and sometimes you may not be having the issues while you're in, and after you get out of service, then you have the issues, and it's affecting not just you, but your social impact with your family, your relationships, and also it's affecting your ability to maintain your job and to be successful. Mm-hmm. So what I would like to plead for those that they don't feel like they deserve, or that even if they've tried and applied before and got denied, please don't give up. You're doing this for yourself. And if you don't want to do it for yourself, do it for your families, because they too, you know, sacrifice while you were serving. They sacrifice when you were gone, or while you were in training, they sacrifice. Also, if they don't feel like their family deserves it, then do it for your fellow veterans. We need your assistance, and also getting our numbers out there so we can get the care that we need, the specialists that we need. And the more we can put our numbers and then we will have the medical services that we need on Guam.
And thank you, Jen, for saying that about please do not give up if you are a vet, because I know a hallmark of anyone who ever wore the uniform in any branch of services, you never leave a man behind. And it's wonderful that veterans like yourselves are reaching out to anybody whoever served, mm-hmm. that you would come forward and be part of this, because it's very, very worthwhile work. All right, we got to run, but Vince, where is the best place, aside from, you know, your wonderful Instagram? How can people get in touch with you and find out more about
You can find us on Instagram as well. It's HMI Guam, and then we have a Facebook, HMI Guam as well. The website is in construction, but it should be launched in the next month, hopefully.
Mm. How about for the old school, like the radio operators who just like want to use like the old school phone?
Well, in the phone number, you can call 671-685-1781, and we can add you to a group chat. The one thing that I want to add as we close, though, or if we're closing, is really the one thing about our boot camp that is really special that you won't get anywhere else is that we have coaches, people like us, people have been through the process, that will walk you through the entire process. Because the biggest problem that most veterans have is like when they get a denial letter, and they don't know what to do. And so what we do at HMI and what we do with the coaches and people that have been trained to look at these is that we look at the denial letter, we see why you got denied, and then we work with you to submit an appeal. Or if you've never been denied and you're trying to file for a disability or to file a claim, we look at your records. We help you get your records if you don't have records. We help you create your accounts. We walk you through the entire thing.
There you go.
and that's really what makes this group special. Because, I mean, if you're just going to do all the basic stuff, you can go to TSN and you go to ASIN and they'll help you, mm-hmm. but they're not going to give you that one-on-one. There's all kinds of different things that we do to help them pretty much hold your hand. We don't want to, but there are some that really need that, because that's why they give up, is because they get confused. There's just so much information. And so we recommend people to just contact the organization, contact one of the officers. And it really is just, it requires, especially if it's, you have a complicated situation, is that we have to, like, there's no one set solution. Like, it's not like we're gonna give you a PDF and that you're gonna follow those three steps, because every situation is different.
All right, so thank you once again, Jen and Vince. Never leave a man behind, of course, and please reach out. Vets, you gotta go to boot camp one more time, and this one is really gonna
benefit. Chalampago. Chalampago, New York.
There you go. All right, Nihinzai KUAM is coming up next.
Guam's auto appearance specialist, Elegant Reflections, has been providing the automotive industry with professional detailing and car care products at its highest quality, from complete detailing, full interior detailing, exterior detailing, headlamp restoration, hand washing, seat and carpet shampoo, engine degreasing, undercarriage cleaning, paint sealant, fabric protection, paint oxidation removal, and so much more. Visit us at our new location. Call 646-5555 for an appointment. Elegant Reflections, Guam's auto appearance specialist, over 20 years of experience.
Howdy, folks. Nobody loves a Guam potluck more than I do. That's why I always bring my world-famous chicken, served any way you like it. Original recipe, extra crispy tenders, Kentucky Fried Wings, and more. Only at KFC Guam. Whoops. Well, it is finger-looking good.
Today on Nihidzan KUAM, we talk about coconut milk. Nihidzan KUAM.
And you know what? You don't waste this. You know what we did with this? What do you think we would feed it to?
Chickens?
Yeah! That's right. Half a day.
Day.
My name's Steve. You can call me Uncle Steve. What's your name?
Nolan.
Do you know what we're going to do today?
Make coconut milk.
That's right. We're going to make Let's and Needs of. And for that, we're gonna need coconut, water, a cloth, a kumzu, and some containers. Well, look at this. We both have our kumzu. You have yours, I have mine. And we're gonna start kumzuing. But before we do, you have to be careful, because look at this. It's very sharp. So if you ever kumzu, make sure somebody's with you, like an adult or your auntie or somebody, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now that you're safe, you get your bowl. Okay, you get your bowl and then you put it right under where you're gonna kumzu. Then you're gonna get your nizuk. Go ahead and get yours. So you cup it good. You're just gonna grind. It's kind of a circular motion. You're kind of pushing against the blade, then pushing down, and you're just turning as you go. You ready to try? Okay. So. Okay. So good. All right. Good job. How are you doing over there?
Not good.
Okay, I'm gonna help you, okay? Just bite the edge. Let the blade bite the edge. Okay, so try move that more. See how you get more meat? So try it.
Good. Oh my gosh.
So when you keep grinding, when you get to the shell, then you stop.